Now, these are actually dragonflies, because if you're going to have a fantasy image, why have fireflies when you can have dragonflies with glowing bottoms? Yeah! Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and Dwayne The Rock Johnson. I've got a fun little tutorial for you today, but I encourage you not to look at this as a set of instructions to create the exact same thing, but rather as a guideline to build something of your own. We're going to cover some different techniques with this creation, all with the goal of helping equip you to create better, stronger photo manipulations in Photoshop. For this reason, I'm not going to provide you with the project files for this tutorial. I want you guys to use your own images and try your own creations. I'm gonna make you do it. This is my way of forcing you to do it. The techniques we're gonna cover can be applied to anything. You may need to tweak a few things, but that's part of the process. So without further ado, here we go. This is our starting point. This is a photo I grabbed of my son when he was about 10 months old. This photo in itself is a photo manipulation because obviously I didn't want him in the box in the water at the same time. So I took a picture of him in the box outside the pool, then dropped the box in the pool, took a photo of the box from the same angle, then I mashed the two together and voila. You can tell that this is not real because I forgot to add his reflection in the water. Oopsies. This alone is a fun little composite, and it gave all the grandmas and grandpas the feels, you know? But I wanted to do more with it. I wanted to push this fantasy of a 10-month-old floating away in a box. I mean, where's the story in this picture? I wanted to give it more story. So that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna go from this to this. Yeah! Two things rose as a challenge right from the get-go with this photograph. The first was that this image was shot in broad daylight with very harsh light, which made what I wanted to do with it very difficult. And two, this photo was shot with a very shallow depth of field. I think I was at 70 millimeters with about f2.8. So you can see that even though his eyes are in focus, the 2 or 3 inches behind him are quickly blurred into obscurity. So finding a suitable background replacement that had that same depth of field was a challenge. But first things first, I needed to completely extract my son from the background. Now there are a number of efficient ways to do this. My preferred method is to use the pen tool. That's the tool that I'm most familiar with. I can do it the most quickly. But depending on the image that you're using, you can use a different method or whatever you're most used to, whatever works for you. So I just drew a line around the subject and added a slight feathering to the edges by going to Select, Modify Feather. I typed in about 0.5 and got rid of that background by clicking on the Layer Mask button at the bottom of my Layers panel. When it came to doing his hat, I opted to use a feathered brush at different sizes so I could cut around his fuzzy hat by hand. And the reason I did this is because the depth of field changed so much between the left side of his hat, which was a little more in focus, and the other side of his hat, which was really out of focus. So I knew that the feathered edge of my cutout was going to have to change based on that depth of field. Next came finding some ocean waves that were shot at the same angle and the same level and at the same depth of field that this photo was taken. I wasn't as concerned with the depth of field because I knew that I could always blur the foreground or the background if I needed to. What I really needed was something that was taken at the same angle. So I found this free image on Pixneo. I knew the sun was in the wrong place for my light source, so I needed to erase that once I dropped it into my project, but this picture happened to have that shallow focus that I was looking for. So I placed Theodore, that's his name by the way, I placed him right in the sharpest point of the photo and masked out the bottom of the box to conform to the wave. Already, I like where this is going. The lighting is wrong, obviously. We'll take steps to fix that later, but so far, compositionally, I like it. I found this free desktop wallpaper of a sunset that I liked. It was big enough to accommodate the size of my background and provided a believable light source for my final composition. I dropped that into my background, flipped it horizontally, and blurred it by about 25 pixels to match the blurriness of my original photo. I tend to like cooler tones in my shadows and warmer tones in my highlights, and since Theodore's skin is already pretty warm, I wanted the sky to complement that. So by double-clicking the sky layer, you can open up the layer styles options. I added a color layer with the blend mode set to color and the opacity at about 40%. Next, I added a color balance layer above the sky and adjusted the yellow and blue tones in the shadows and the mid-tones to begin injecting that color that I like, that I just told you about, to make my shadows a little blue and my highlights a little warm. Now, color balance is a great way to create some uniformity in your colors in any project, but every photo is different, every project is different, so you're going to have to play with those sliders just a little bit to figure out what works for your project. And we'll play around with the colors a little bit more in the end, but first, let's get the rest of this composition in place. No matter what you're adding to a composite like this, you always have to consider your light source. That always has to be the number one thing that you're thinking about, because ultimately the lighting is going to make or break your image. So I added a shadow of Teddy and his boat to the water by creating a new layer, naming it Shadows. Gotta stay organized. And taking a soft-edged brush set to black and just painting in a shadow adjacent to the light source. It's okay if it's not perfect. Next, I went to Filter, Distort, Wave, and I made sure that only the horizontal scale was applied, and around 60 generators seemed appropriate for this image, but you can use more, you can use less. Then I set the blend mode to soft light. Now, once I did that, it turned the water underneath it to this weird golden color, which was not appropriate for a shadow. So I applied a hue saturation adjustment layer, desaturated the colors by about 80%, and to make sure this effect was applied only to the shadows, I created a selection from the shadow layer by right-clicking on the shadow layer's icon and used the mask on the hue saturation layer to make sure this effect influenced no other parts of the image except what was resting under this shadow layer. Next, I flipped the image of Theodore and the box to create a reflection in the water. Now, but first, to permanently apply this layer mask, I created a new layer and merged it with the layer of Theodore. Now, you can also right-click on the layer and convert it to a smart object if you want to retain the ability to edit the layer mask. But I knew that I was done with the layer mask. I didn't need it, so whatever, just flatten the image, so long as you retain that transparent background. Set the blend mode to overlay. I added some rippling through the filter gallery in the same way that I added waves to the shadow, and erased some of the more distant edges for a more natural falloff. I actually did this twice to add a little more distortion to the reflection and also to make some areas of the reflection a little more prominent than others. I don't have an exact process when I approach a digital manipulation. I usually have a pretty good idea of what I want to do, but the parts that I tackle first are the parts that are going to sell me on whether or not I can make this to my satisfaction. And that varies from photograph to photograph. If there's something that's really challenging, I'll tackle that first to see if I can do it, see if I can make it look good before I do anything else. Like in this photograph, I knew that if I couldn't nail the water reflections and the shading, I wasn't gonna like the finished photograph. So the next thing I tackled was the shading in an attempt to bring down those harsh highlights on Theodore. I started with his hat by creating a new levels adjustment layer and bringing down those shadows, paying attention to how it was affecting the highlights on the hat. Once I had it where I wanted, I applied a layer mask, filled it with black to hide the effect. Remember, black layer masks hide the image they're attached to, or the effect that they're attached to. Painting on a layer mask with white will reveal that effect, or reveal the image only where you want it to. So to help me get just the area of the hat, I created a selection from the Theodore layer. I should probably rename this to keep things clear. Then I painted over the hat using a white brush. I took the opacity down about 50% since I ultimately felt the effect was too strong. Once I saw that the addition of these shadows was helping to tone down that harsh light and make it look a little more natural, I was confident that I could make that work throughout the rest of the photograph, and so I began placing the rest of my elements to see how the composition would look. And that's pretty much my approach to something like this. I tackle those parts that I think are going to be the most difficult or the hardest sell, because if I can't make those parts convincing, then there's no use trying to do any of the easier stuff, but that's just me. I knew I wanted his stuffed bear hanging off the side of the box, so I took a picture of it outside in approximately the same lighting conditions. I cut the bear out of the image the same way that I used to extract Theodore from the background of his image. I dropped the bear into my project. Once I had it positioned where I wanted it, I duplicated the image, flipped it vertically, set the blend mode to overlay at about 70% opacity, and then added some shadows to the stuffed bear in the same way that I added shadows to Teddy's hat. To do that, I made a selection of the bear. Then on a new layer, I painted on some black shadows with a big feathered brush. This toned down the harsh light on the stuffed bear and made it blend into the image a lot more. I'll add more shadows later, but I want to see how the rest of the composition comes together first. I created this flag, which could probably be a video tutorial all in itself. I dropped it into the image, flipped it so it was going the other way, sized it to about where I wanted it. I added some shadows to the flag in the same way I've been doing to make it conform to the light source. This time, however, I followed that same process for some highlights. I needed this flagpole to reflect the same lighting conditions. So the right side needed to be in shadow, but the left side needed to have this little beam of light coming down that one side of it. That would also help give it some dimension. Remember, always keep your light source in mind. It'll make or break your imagery. Since the flag was behind my main subject and therefore out of focus, I applied a slight blur to the entire thing. I also took the lasso tool with a 25-point feather and selected the tail end of the flag and added a little bit of motion blur, not much, just enough to give the impression that this thing was moving around a little bit. I found a free image of an old compass online and I dropped that into my image, resized it, and placed it where I thought it looked good. To add a reflection, I did what we've done several times now. Duplicated it, flipped it vertically, went to Filter, Distort, Wave to add a little rippling effect, set the blend mode to overlay. You can try playing around with the opacity of some of these reflection layers if you want to, or even grab an eraser brush, set it at like 40-50% opacity, and just brush over some of those areas of the reflection to get it to blend in a little more. I added a shadow to the compass by duplicating it and using the levels tool to make it all black. I used Photoshop's warp function to pull the shadow along the side of the box, while keeping in mind that the shadow would be closest to the compass wherever the compass was closest to the box. And the parts of the compass that were farther away from the box, the shadow would be a little bit bigger and pull away from the compass a little bit. I did this twice, actually, setting one shadow layer at about 60% opacity and a second one feathered a lot more to create a little more shading under Theodore's arm. I created a third shadow layer on top of the compass because the face of the compass was just way too bright. So to do that, I right-clicked the compass to create a selection, and then on a new layer, I filled it with black, set the opacity to about 60%, and erased a few parts of the shadow to reveal some key details of the compass. You'll also notice that he's holding the compass by this little leather string. To get that, I simply took a picture of some string, extracted it from the background using the same pen tool technique that I've used before, and I erased this one little piece of string here to give the impression that it's actually looped around the compass, and then that was it. That was pretty much all I did to throw that little string in there. Now to add some more shading. So I created a new layer, made a selection of my main subject from the mask that I created, and with a dark feathered brush, I painted in some shadows all around the box. I used the eraser tool to lessen the shadows where I didn't want them to be as intense, and I fiddled around with this until I felt like the lighting was starting to match the background and the light source of the image. I think in total, I ended up with 5 or 6, maybe 7 different shadow layers, just doing the same thing over and over, just building up those shadows until I felt like all the lighting in the image was starting to look a little more natural. I brushed on some additional shading to cover those water highlights right under the box, as well as some additional shading as I felt needed. Bear in mind that this is a fantasy image, and if the lighting here were 100% realistic, there would be a lot of cute little details that we wouldn't be able to see. So even though I am trying to get some realistic lighting, I'm not trying to push it so much that it's not still kind of a fantasy, you know? Now onto the fireflies. Now these are actually dragonflies, because if you're going to have a fantasy image, why have fireflies when you can have dragonflies with glowing bottoms? These little guys were actually really simple. It took a long time because I did 6 individual dragonflies that I then duplicated a bunch of times, and so creating those 6 individual dragonflies took a long time, but the effect itself is actually really easy. So I found some free stock images of dragonflies. The pictures don't even have to be that great of quality because we're going to add some motion blur and they're going to be pretty small. Select the lasso tool and just quickly cut out the dragonfly. I'm not using the pen tool here to extract it from the background for reasons that you'll see in a minute. I don't need that precise of a cutout. Close enough will do. Once I've made my cutout, delete the background. Boom, here we go. Now, I wanted my dragonflies to have all the same coloring, so I used the hue and saturation controls to give them all approximately the same sort of bluish-green hue. And then I just pasted them into my project. Now remember, for this particular image, I have a very shallow depth of field, so depending on where my dragonflies are placed, most of them are probably going to be out of focus. To make them glow, I used a simple two-layer process. The first layer, a soft yellow color. I'll put the color code in the bottom of the screen, just in case you want to know. I grabbed a big soft edge brush and put a dab or two of this color right over the tail. Set the opacity to about 70%. I made a second layer above this one, picked a brighter, more vibrant yellow, almost a golden yellow, made my brush size about twice as big, and put one big dab right over the first one. Set the blend mode to overlay. You may have to adjust the opacity a little bit depending on where in the image this goes. If it's in a brighter spot, you may want it a little brighter. If it's in a darker spot where that glow really stands out, you may need to lower the opacity. I also want to give these guys some motion. So I took a lasso tool and set the feathering to about 25 pixels. I then made a selection of each individual dragonfly wing and applied a slight motion blur by going to filter, blur, motion blur. And I set the angle to match the angle of the wing and the distance to around 20 or 30, depending on the size of the dragonfly. I intentionally placed some dragonflies close to objects so that I could use some reflections and light casts to make them feel like they were really a part of the image. I made a reflection of this guy by using the same technique I've used on everything else in this picture so far. I added a little extra motion blur, changed the blend mode to overlay and the opacity to about 70%. I created some light casts on the flag and the box by using a simple feathered brush and dropping a spot of color on the flag to make it look like this dragonfly was just zooming past the flag at this very moment, casting a little bit of light onto that fabric. I did the same thing down here on the box, but first I right-clicked on the image mask of Theodore to create a selection around the box, and then just dabbed a little bit of dragonfly yellow right there. Set the opacity to about 70%, The last little finishing touch to the dragonflies is making some reflections in the water. Now, one of the things I've learned from shooting sunsets here on Maui for so many years is that a reflection never hits the water once. It hits the water once and then again and again and again. So to make some reflections for my dragonflies, I created a new layer. I took a small feathered brush and began adding in some dabs of golden reflection along the surface of the water coming towards the camera, somewhat following the natural reflections that were already in the water. I then went to filter, distort, wave, made sure to turn off the vertical fluctuations in only about 5 or 6 generators, and set the blend mode to overlay. Then I lowered the opacity to about 70%. I decided that the color of the reflections was a little too intense, so I brought up the hue saturation controls and brought the saturation down and the lightness up until I felt like it looked a little more natural. Lastly, I took an eraser at about 50% opacity and zoomed in to shape some of those reflections to conform more to the waves. And that just about does it for the dragonflies. Very simple, but lots of little clicks and details to be mindful of. To make up a bunch of background dragonflies, I simply created a new layer, added a feathered white dot, and added an inner glow to the image, normal blend mode, 70% opacity, and an outer glow set to overlay at about 100% opacity, depending on where in the image it was. So I think these look like fireflies, I mean dragonflies, or maybe it's pixie dust, I don't know, I'm not sure. But the story is strong in this image, which every image should be. And I think that's why I wanted to do a really intense photo manipulation on this picture, is because the image is cute, but I really wanted to tell a story, which is something I encourage everyone to do with every photo manipulation that you approach. Just a few finishing details. For this dark, empty portion of the image up here, I decided to add a little star field peeking out. Now, there are a number of ways to create a star field, but I found this really great free brush pack on DeviantArt. Free to download, all you need is a user account, and I'll post a link in the description below. So I selected a star shape that I liked, and under the brush settings, I adjusted the spacing, size, jitter, and scattering until I could populate a star field with different sized stars without going too over the top. I actually did this twice. The first one I did this was on a layer with a bunch of small stars, which I set at about 50% opacity. Then I added a second layer with larger stars and changed the opacity to about 80%. And then I blurred both layers by about 5 pixels, so just give it a little black background blur. I added some sun rays in the background to enhance the sun rays that were already in the picture. I just took my lasso tool with about a 10 pixel feather, made a selection, and on a new layer, I filled it with white, set the blend mode to overlay and the opacity way down to about 8%. So there were a few finishing touches that I applied globally to really make the fantasy feeling of this picture pop. First, I added a brightness and contrast adjustment layer to take the contrast down a little bit. This softened the shadows and made Theodore's face just a little bit brighter. Like I said earlier, I like injecting my shadows with cool tones and my highlights with warm tones, so I added a selective color adjustment layer and tweaked the handles so that it would give me a dark cyan look to my shadows and a little bit more warmth to my highlights. Essentially, what this is going to do is sort of bring about a balance to all of my colors. You know, there's a lot of things going on in this image, there's a variety of colors and tones, we've got a lot going on, but I want to bring some uniformity to it all so that it all looks and feels like it's a part of the same situation, the same picture. But these settings in the adjustment layers is something that you're going to have to fiddle with per image to see what works for you. Lastly, I added a sun flare to the left to help complement the remaining strong light on Theodore, and I set that below the selective color adjustment layer. I did this by creating a new layer, then picking a large soft brush and selecting a dark burnt orange. Make a big orange dot, set the blend mode to screen, resize it, and place it where you want it to go, and I took the opacity down to about 60%. So that's about it. Could I add more shadows? Of course. Is this lighting realistic? Of course not. Like I said earlier, the image is intended to be a fantasy, and if the lighting here were 100% realistic, we wouldn't be able to see some of the details that are telling the story. So there's a bit of compromise here, but it's worth it in the end. From start to finish, this took me about 5 hours to complete. Anyway, I hope this was educational and that it encourages you guys to try something like this on your own. Let me know if you'd like to see more stuff like this, or if there's anything I could have done better, if there's anything that wasn't clear, let me know in the comments down below. Imagine and you'll learn, learn and you'll grow. We'll talk to you next time.